I don't really think Laura's always been a person of faith. Laura has been a person who has paid attention to signs. She's a person who, due to sort of hallucinogenic drugs, was able to see through a certain dimension. And therefore, Laura has been responsible to interpretation of the scriptures. Somewhere in all of that, I think Laura prays now and then. I think she has a very strong connection to the idea of destiny, but faith is a whole different matter. I mean, there is general faith in life and afterlife. There's faith in your fellow beings. There's faith as a religious practice, and I'm not sure any of those apply to Laura, but belief in destiny and belief in signs are certainly part of her, and respect for the religious part of her population is very much a part of Laura. But she herself, I wouldn't say, was clearly, to my knowledge, a woman of faith. Hope and belief in destiny. I think she really does have a feeling that all of it's quite destined. Otherwise, why in the world would she be there? There's no reason to be there except to participate in the destiny of this particular group of people on their way to resettlement. I mean, she started off by being a dying woman who had absolutely no business being alive nor being a president. Therefore, I think that she's been given a big lesson in something that she needed to serve. And I think in that sense, there's a belief in something larger. But it isn't really, I wouldn't necessarily call her a woman of faith. Laura has to compromise when she returns to the presidency, firstly by having to work out some kind of diplomatic agreement or political agreement with Tom Zarek, who has been the president becomes the president because he is vice president to Baltar. Now, Tom Zarek obviously has been a nemesis of Laura's for quite a while. But they have to come to an agreement because Laura needs to step back into the presidency. So that would, I'd say, would be the first compromise, which turns out to be kind of interesting. It gets deeper and more complicated once Tom Zarek's agenda is exposed. So first it's just sort of a political agreement, let's say, that she will step back up and turn around and appoint him her vice president. So if he's willing to step down, she'll step up and then bring him with her. So right there we have this little political compromise. But then it turns out that he's been up to something that Laura finds very difficult. And the irony is that rather than it actually being forcing Laura into a compromise, Tom Zarek's radical actions force Laura into growth. And I think that she probably takes, in my opinion, one of the stronger steps as a president that she's taken by forming a different response to the pain and the loss that the fleet has endured under the Cylon occupation. She really does a 360 and creates the possibility for forgiveness. And that's a new move for her. And she's kind of forced into it. So to a certain extent, it was a compromise, but it was a welcome moment of growth as experienced by Laura. The trust that exists between Adama and Laura is not really, I would say, is not really supported by anything specific. What's happened between Laura and Adama is over the years of working together and over the years of going through such difficult circumstances, even though they're quite often differing opinions, they just grow into a kind of an acceptance of the balancing that they provide for each other. Would I call it complete trust? No. Would I say that there's a healthy working trust at the top of three? Well, at the top of three, they're not even together. He's up in the sky and she's down on the planet. She never, ever, ever loses her belief that he will try and come and get them because she's experienced that commitment in him before. Once she is president again, they do some very good work together. But then as the season moves on, there's a couple of issues that emerge that they once again find themselves on the opposite sides of the table. I wouldn't say, though, that whatever trust they've developed goes away. I just think that as with any relationship that has power in it, and any relationship that has to continue, we don't have a choice to not really like each other. It's more like a marriage than a working relationship. I think that we're forced to put up with a few things and move on. In other words, nobody's throwing anybody in jail anymore if they don't like what they're saying. We move on. Well, she hasn't come into contact with Sharon much at all. To be perfectly honest, this is a hypothetical projection. People keep thinking that she's seen Sharon a lot and she's watched her grieve and all these kind of things, but in fact, she hasn't at all. I haven't been in the same room with Sharon but twice in the three seasons. And in season number three, I have yet to be in the same room as Sharon. So there is... There's not a lot of connection for me with Sharon. There's this deep, deep psychological connection for me with the child. Not only because out of the blue, when I thought I was dying, Baltar, for very different reasons of his own, had nothing to do with me, really, did the stem cell transplant, so I'm connected to that child, but because the child has a resonance for the future of the human race, and because I felt very, very strongly that we needed to protect this child because somebody was going to go after this child. So she has a deep connection to the child being somehow connected to the possibility of the future, and perhaps deep down in Laura, the possibility of a bridge, a possibility of understanding. But that's not a level that she's working on right now. She's working on a much more protective and disciplined, I wouldn't exactly call it political, but it's really about survival. So I think, though, depending on what's coming up in season three and depending on what we need to see, there is strong possibility for her to have to be forced to be more connected to Sharon. And in therein lies a certain amount of interesting hope. If you step outside of Battlestar Galactica and see Laura's ability, or I do, and see Laura's inability to respond to the Cylon element as human, or respond to the likeness, but to continually respond to the threat. The possibility of being forced once again into movement, to shift, to awareness, perhaps there is some hope in there. I don't know yet, though, what they're about to write. So they've surprised me before when I thought we were going a kinder, gentler way, and no, we don't go that way. So I'm not really sure. It's Laura's position in life inside this world is always about the many. She doesn't really have the freedom, or so she thinks, she doesn't have the freedom to really respond to the self or the few. She has very little, very few friends. She has no children. She has very few relationships on the Battlestar Galactica. We don't see a lot of her personal life ever because there isn't one. frankly. Her entire being is thinking, processing, trying to understand, looking for clues, and making decisions based on the survival of the fleet. Which is why I feel, like I said earlier, that one of the my favorite moments of Laura's so far, the most interesting to me, was the turn that she has to do in 4. And the change in the... I don't know how much I can say, how much of a spoiler you want, but she develops a truth and reconciliation program to respond to the horrible, horrible upheaval that's happening within the crew once we leave the nightmare of being an occupied nation. And there's a lot of crimes that were committed, and there's a lot of people who did horrific things, and there's a phenomenal amount of rage, as one might understand. And her response ultimately to this is to create a program that allows people to give it up and to forgive, rather than move into, as ironically Tom Zarek talks about this, we would be moving into a period of relentless blame, and it could tie up our lives forever, really. That's a moment where her commitment to the many is able to go into a philosophical and moral territory that has air in it. Most of the time, her commitment to the many has to be very ruthless, and it requires something very, very painful. And this is one of the few times that her commitment to the many incorporated air, where she was able to say, let's go this way. This, in the long run, will ensure our future forgiveness. Now, how long does that last? Where does it go? We've very quickly then we're dealing with all kinds of other things right away. But there was, to me, the hint of something that I personally responded to very strongly. There's a lot of times when I'm playing Laura, I need to truly define a line between us, politically, emotionally, sometimes even our thought process. So mine, natural process, is so different from what Laura's response has had to develop into in order to ensure her position, her commitment, and what she feels she's being asked to do by destiny. So this was one of the few moments where I felt like she and I could be completely in agreement. So I particularly liked it. It's a nice feeling.